Hello, and this is a video about glycolysis, and I'm following Clark, Choi, and Douglas's Biology 2E freeware out of Rice, I think, University. Glycolysis is a process whereby glucose is broken down in cells to provide energy, and it is a very detailed process. And so I don't know how, you know, if you're taking a biology class, I don't know how much detail your professor will expect you to know. I've tried to simplify it as much as I can, but it is a very detailed process. So what is glycolysis? It is the first kind of part of breaking down glucose. Glucose is sugar, right? C6H12O6, but it's a ring. Glucose is a ring structure. The carbons are in a cycle, and there are different kind of appendages on different carbons. But it's mostly C6. Well, it's C6H12O6. That's what it is. So glycolysis is kind of the first phase of breaking down sugar into energy that cells can use. Nearly all living organisms operate by glycolysis, both eukaryotes and prokaryotes. Now, there might be a few freaks on the margins of the living spectrum, you know, the kind of strange organisms that can live around volcanoes, that sort of thing. But nearly all organisms use glycolysis to break down sugars. It's an anaerobic process, which means that it doesn't require oxygen for it to happen. So that's a feature of it. It takes place in the cytoplasm. That's the gooey, juicy middle of a cell, right? Both pro and eukaryotes, again, do this. Okay, I believe prokaryotes don't have nucleus. Eukaryotes do. I think that's, if I remember that correctly, please ignore me if I'm wrong there. Okay, so what's it all about, glycolysis? It starts with glucose. Well, that makes sense because glycolysis is the process of breaking down glucose. That makes sense. It ends with pyruvate molecules. And if I have time, I'll try to make a video that'll go along with this on the citric cycle. That basically this video starts the process, and then we hand it off to, you know, the citric cycle. So starts with glucose, it ends with pyruvate molecules. That's what this glycolysis process starts with glucose, ends with pyruvate. It will have a net gain of 2 adenosine triphosphate molecules. It actually, the process produces 4, but it takes 2. The first half of glycolysis requires 2 ATPs to get it going, but it'll generate 4 ATPs in the second half, and that'll leave a net gain of 2 adenosine triphosphate molecules at the end of it all. And it will end with 2 molecules of NADH, which is the reduced form of NAD+, the H being a hydrogen. So these are energy. These are the coinage of energy in the cell. Okay, as you know. Okay, so the first 5 steps. What are the first? So there's 10 steps. The first 5 steps of glycolysis. What are they? First, we add a phosphate. Then we shift the structure around a little. These are both isomers. They have the same. They're both C6H12O. I don't know. There's a phosphate added onto it. I don't know. So it alters it a little bit. So, glucose phosphate to fructose phosphate, isomers, same chemical formula, different arrangement. And then we pour in more phosphate in stage number 3. And then, hi-ya, in step 4, we cut that sucker in half. And that leaves 2 different parts, but they're still tight slightly differently. And so the 5th step is where we make them the same. Okay, so first 5 steps. Add phosphate, shift it around into a different isomer, more phosphate, hi-ya! And then we make the two the same. Okay, that's the first step. Break it down a little bit. I don't know whether you need to know this or not, or whether my little hi-ya, you know, is enough. But the first half of glycolysis. Now let's do this in slow motion. So first step one, get phosphate. We call the adding of phosphate phosphorylation, the adding of phosphate. I never knew phosphate was so important. I thought it was just something you used with your laundry. But anyway, so glucose is a ring. It's a ring structure. And all of these steps seem to involve enzymes. Let me remind you what an enzyme is. An enzyme is a certain kind of protein that's kind of like a docking station. Remember, molecules dock, they get, that facilitates their change, and then they undock. Enzymes can help put things together. Enzymes can help break things apart. But enzymes are catalysts. They're proteins that help make things happen. So I didn't mention, so almost all of these steps involve some sort of enzyme. The first step involves an enzyme called hexokinase. Hex means six, so I said there's six kin in this enzyme family. The hexokin. Anyway, I stopped after this slide. I stopped trying to come up with cutesy things for the enzymes. I'm assuming your professor doesn't require you to know all the enzymes that are involved in this process. Maybe she does, I don't know. But anyway, glucose is a ring. Step one, add phosphate. An enzyme named hexokinase helps the phosphate attach to the glucose. So we end up with a glucose phosphate at the end of step one, okay? So remember, step one, add phosphate. Step two, glucose phosphate to fructose phosphate. Again, same chemical formula. These are two different isomers and still in a ring structure, I believe. Now, the fructose phosphate is easier to split. Remember, we're coming up to the hi-ya, you know, and so we're slowly rearranging things, getting ready for the hi-ya. By the way, an isomerase is something that makes an isomer. So isomer ace. And so it's a particular kind of, I think, enzyme that makes isomers. So there's an enzyme. I didn't write down what it's called. I don't remember what it's called. There's an isomerase that helps reshuffle the Rubik's Cube to change glucose phosphate into fructose phosphate. It's the same chemical formula, two different arrangements, two different looks. And so that's stage two, where the Rubik's Cube alteration. So step one is get phosphate. Step two is glucose phosphate to fructose phosphate. Change the Rubik's Cube. Step three, more phosphate. More phosphorylation. Add more phosphate. So it now becomes fructose biphosphate. Bi means two, right? I'm a biped. I have two legs. So more phosphate. I need me more phosphate. And again, and then enzymes make these things happen. Okay. This particular enzyme, some of the enzymes that are involved in this process help control the rate. Like the enzyme just stops helping things happen when it's got enough. I'm sorry, I'm not doing the Rubik's Cube anymore until we get some of you people out of here. So step one, add phosphate. Step two, isomerize. Step three, more phosphate. Steps four and five, chop it in two, hi-ya! Which leaves us with two isomers that are three carbon. So we had six carbon, right? Glucose, fructose, or six carbon, C6. And hi-ya! Now we have C3PO, C3P something. Not actually, it might be C3PO. I don't know. I mean, not exactly, but there's some oxygen hiding around here, right? And some phosphate. And so, wow, I missed an opportunity. Okay, step five, make them into the same isomer. So these two carbon isomers that come out of step four are they're different isomers. And so step five uses a an enzyme to make the isomers the same, an isomerase to make them the same. And they end up as glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, meaning that the phosphate is on the third carbon. Okay, so that's step one. That's the part one of the breakdown of glycerol. By the way, this process is cost two. This first half is cost two ATPs. That's where we got the that's where the phosphate's from. That's where the phosphate's from. Because we remember we were adding phosphate. We're getting them from two ATPs. Okay, so again, what is the first half of glycolysis? The first phase is add some phosphate, switch the isomer, add more phosphate, hi-ya! And then make them both the same. Okay, step one, first phase. Now we come to phase, here's a picture. A lovely picture. So let me see if we can remember what they are. So we started off with a lovely glucose, and then we used the hexokinase enzyme, and we grabbed a phosphate, added a phosphate to it. And then this is the isomerase, another enzyme that basically switches them around into fructose, glucose to fructose. So first we add a phosphate, then we isomerize it. I just made up that word. Then we take another phosphate, and then we split it, hi-ya, and we end up with two different isomers, and then we make them the same isomer. Okay, phase one, add a phosphate, Rubik's cube, glucose to fructose, add another phosphate, hi-ya, break it in two, and then make them both the same isomer. Okay, stage two. So first, oxidize, release the electrons. Glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is oxidized so that it loses electrons. It burps one of its phosphates to make another ATP, maybe two even. The phosphate moves down, passes it along the chain, loses some water, leaving it a PE pyruvate. I don't remember what PE stands for. You'll find on the next slide. And then it burps some more electrons, or burps another phosphate to form another ATP, leaving pyruvic acid. And so once it gets here, it's going to pass, the pyruvic acid is going to go into the next step, the citric cycle, more energy process, but this is the glycolysis part of the getting the energy out of the sugar. Again, it oxidizes that glyceraldehyde, and then it burps off a phosphate for some ATP. The phosphate moves on the structure. It loses a water, dehydration, which leaves it in a particular compound called PEP, and it burps another phosphate, forms another ATP, and leaves pyruvic acid. So here's the diagram. So we started with glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. And so it's going to oxidize, as it oxidizes this, it loses electrons, which allows this to reduce to NADH. NADH is, again, farther on the path of energy. And you're going to get two ATP molecules out of this. Then it's going to, it burps a phosphate to get two ATP. And then we're going to see the phosphate move from here to here. So it changes its location on the structure. Then it dehydrates, loses a water, leaving PEP. Oh, here's what PEP is. It's phosphoenol pyruvate, anyway. And then finally, it's going to give off that phosphate, and it's going to end up with the pyruvate, which actually looks like a fairly simple molecule, but it has an extra double bond here. So this is a lot of detail, and I don't have it all down. But so what happens here? Glyceraldehyde oxidizes, which means it loses electrons, which allows this ion to become NADH, which is energy. Then it's going to burp off a phosphate to make some ATP. Then a phosphate's going to move on the structure. Then it's going to dehydrate, lose a water, giving this, and then it's going to burp off a phosphate and we'll end up with pyruvate. Well, I'm not sure that's real helpful, but I don't know how much your professor wants you to know, but we've ended up, let me go back to the beginning to sum it all up, because I don't like to end on a lack of clarity. What's it all about? It's a process that starts with glucose, glycolysis, and ends with pyruvate molecules. It has a net gain of 2 ATP molecules by the time it's all done because of the burping of the phosphates, and it ends up with 2 molecules of NADH, which again is an energy form that the cells use, and that's basically what glycolysis is all about, from glucose to pyruvate. Okay, well, I did my best for tonight, and we'll be back maybe tomorrow with the citric cycle.